Hungerdome, the TV show, episode 7, Fair Economics, featuring Glynnos.
Welcome to this 7th edition of Hungerdome, the TV show. Anyway, we did have a guest scheduled, more than one actually, but they bailed out, so it's just me. And it's probably a good idea anyway, because this whole economics thing, which is going to be the subject, economics, a system of principles regulating the game of production and consumption. Yeah, that about says it. We're basically just consuming and producing machines, and we all have an existence, a place. We're either producing enough to justify our consumption, or we're not. And that's basically the game, is just to get the most you can out of us without burdening us too heavily. That's one of the principles. The principle is slavery be bad, okay? And if you can figure out a few of those little basic ideas, then you can have a system that has incentives, that has doesn't have to be everybody gets the same and all that kind of stuff. It doesn't have to be bread and water. And yet it can be fair and reasonable and rationally able to do what we want it to do, which is to just maximize the efficiency, make us both efficient producers and efficient consumers. That should be our goal. But that's too complicated, right? The simple solution is just to make us all some owner's property, and then just assume that the owners will act in their own interest and try to make us good property for them to trade. You know, it's like owning an ant farm, right? If you owned ant farms, you could trade them based on how much stuff the ants produced, you know, and how little the ants consumed. And you could trade them, you know, with each other based on how productive your little ant farm was. Well, that's sort of the system we've decided to accept, is that there's these very few mega owners, and they basically own us and trade us based on how much they can grind out of us, so to speak. But there would be an incentive not to kill us and all this. All the rationalizations for slavery still exist in capitalism. And then there's this alternative, like I said. It's not like I'm anti-capitalist, but, you know, the alternative is this idiotic notion that everybody's entitled to everything, which is also stupid. We do have to have some stick if we're going to be productive, right? You're not gonna work unless somebody forces you to, right? Nobody wants to go to work. Nobody wants to be productive. Productivity usually requires a kind of a sacrifice or some sort of risk or some sort of something not pleasant. It just isn't all this whistle why you work stuff. There aren't those kind of, reality doesn't provide those kind of jobs. So there has to be a system that tries to grind a little bit more out of us than what we would give voluntarily. So it can't be too touchy-feely, kind and gentler. There's got to be a whip, and there's got to be carrots. And really, so this will just be a discussion of the current system and why it fails. And there's just two really big reasons. Like, capitalism could work, actually. You know, for all you people who are anti-capitalism, if you just got rid of inheritance, if you just got rid of the legacy component. See, I put the game, word game, in here. You know, the game of production and consumption, and then the word sport, because that's really where it all goes wrong. Capitalism is bad sport when you allow it to be inherited. When you make it permanent and you make it unearned, you know, just legacy, permanent legacy ownership. There, it's in capital letters. I was supposed to get to that later, but permanent legacy ownership of surplus in the means of production. That's where it all goes wrong, because that's like having baseball, you know, inherited baseball, inherited membership in the, you know, in the, what do you call it when you win the greatest players in the world club. You wouldn't let people inherit a ticket. You don't let people inherit a driver's license. You don't let people, you wouldn't have a horse race where the horses were given head starts. And it's just an overt cheat. And you can't touch that argument. So if you're if you're listening to this and you're some capitalist saying, oh yeah, 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 there's no other argument. It's cheating. Okay, it's the biggest game in the world. It's bigger than Major League Baseball and bigger than the NFL and bigger than the Olympics even. It's the biggest game in town. It can kill you. That's how big the game is, right? It's life and death game. And you're just cheating. You're just advocating for a cheat. I mean, inheritance is cheating. You know, simple, plain and simple. Especially, we're talking big inheritance, right? You could get away with having $1 million limit or something, and say if your little retarded spawn can't get by on $1 million head start, then it's probably too broken, right? That's the Darwin rule. Yeah, it's probably a Darwin failure if it can't get away. If it can't get through life on $1 million head start, then probably it should be eradicated. It should be ground up by the machine. But really, that's the biggest corruption of capitalism, is they take the earning out of it. Earning has nothing to do with it. And most of these ownership claims in the world today are possessed by people who never did a day's work to earn it, never did anything to earn it. Okay, they're just collecting the paycheck. And I think that's just so stupid. It's obscenely stupid. So that's the big one. The second argument I would make is that besides regulating, the excesses of giving it away not based on merit, okay, have a merit system, there's something intrinsically corrupting about ownership. Even if you had employees and they owned the business, as soon as they're owners, they start thinking different. They start thinking about how they can screw the consumers over so they can get another week off. You know, they start thinking of rackets and gimmicks and chicanery and small print that somehow will do them an advantage as producers, and they'll take it out of the consumers. And it's just a very destructive seduction. Okay, to be put in, it just corrupts people, plain and simple. And so you're better off without it, and we can do without it. We don't have to have publicly owned business. We can just have business set up, and there's a CEO who's hired and fired by the workers and the consumers. So just balance the power between the consumers and the workers, and you can have a viable, honest means of production, something that's trying to produce a good product for the consumer and trying to be fair to the workers. I mean, that really shouldn't be beyond our capacity. I mean, if we can own nuclear bombs and drop them occasionally, I think we should be able to take responsibility for providing for those two things, a fair deal for a worker and a fair deal for a consumer. It really isn't that difficult. So anyway, this isn't going exactly how I planned it, but let's start at the beginning again. So a system of principles regulating the game of production and consumption. Right, so the principle would be basically, look, human beings are producers of value and they're consumers of value. We have the ability to produce and the need to consume. And all you really want to do is you want to maximize how much we produce, but you just don't want to do it in a slave context. I mean, obviously, that's, slavery is easy. Yeah, just enslave people, you get more production out of them, you get to the future faster and all that kind of stuff, but yeah, the price is just too high. So you want something short of slavery to do your efficient production thing. And then you just want to do this, reasonable distribution of the value, what's produced, and the fact that we will consume it and that we all have levels of comfort. And it's nice to have somebody clean your house and somebody mow your grass and somebody, fix or do maintenance or whatever and do all these things for you. And so those are the privileges of being productive, is that you would have people. Okay, but there has to be a limit, a rational limit to how consumptive you're going to be. I mean, it's just reasonable to think what's the allowable high maintenance? How high maintenance are you allowed to be? Are you allowed to really consume $1 million or $2 million in frivolous nonsense a year? Is that reasonable for one breathing human being? especially if that human being isn't really producing anything. I mean, it's not like you're producing unification theories or something. So really, that's just this idea that you just want production without slavery, and you want consumption that just isn't nonsensically, outrageously stupid, wasteful. I mean, waste is down here, right? The waste of dishonest production and extravagant consumption. Right there. I mean, that's probably enough said right there. That's the enemy. Waste is the enemy. And to think that capitalism unregulated is going to give you a non-waste system is just, it's not very smart. I mean, you have to regulate it. You have to control it. Because we know where it goes in the end anyway, right? Monarchy, you know, the whole idea that you just end up with a hierarchy, and whoever has the most stuff ends up with the most advantage, you know, the most leverage to, you know, corner the gold market or do some other cornering of some market, and playing all kinds of William Randolph Hearst games, and basically breaking the game again. The game. So, I mean, this is the system of principles regulating the game. So you understand that, right? You know that every game we play, you know, as a sport, that there's umpires, there's rules, you know, that it has to be regulated. Because we know that it's just in the selfish nature of people to cheat. If you give them the chance to, you know, dig out the middle of the bat and shove it with cork, they're going to do it. So you have to have rules against it. You know, if a little longer spike on their shoe will get the job done, scare the other guy, you know, then yeah, they'll do it. We're just not very honorable people, you know, nature-wise, you know, viscerally. And so you have to have a system that obliges us to be honorable and fair in our interaction with each other.
Well, hello! It's Beatrice Bourgeois. And since slumming it on the internet is so très chic these days, I thought I would throw the peasants at Vlogadome the proverbial bone by answering one of the pathetic questions about fair economics. No need, by the way, to reward me with the $25 prize money for my answer. That's far too paltry a sum for my time. The real invoice is in the mail. In Mendham, an old fan asks, in the economic game of life, should every individual's position be earned by their contribution? Or should the cheat of an inherited head start be allowed to break the game? My dear, dear little peasants of Vlogadome, I don't see where this unfairness you speak of lies. Everyone falls out of a vagina, as you're always reminding us. Some vaginas just have larger bank accounts attached to them. That's just the way things are. I'm special. I'm important. And my blood just happens to be bluer than lapis lazuli. And I'm a wonderful person. All my slaves get thrown a tin of Spam on Christmas. My jets and yachts run on only the finest and most highly distilled and environmentally friendly blood of the poor. Surely I deserve copious compensation for my philanthropy. How dare you suggest otherwise, you elitist pigs! And really, if the game is broken, I don't know why you haven't asked your fathers to just buy you a new one yet. Does that answer your question? You're welcome.
All right, so anyway, let's get to this thing. So balance productivity. So that would just mean something like, again, something short of slavery, yes. Yeah, just something, a system that just doesn't go too far. I mean, really, like I said, we really do want to try to get the most out of ourselves. We really do want to try to encourage people to make value for the world. You know, we're doing it now in a current system where they're making value by writing small print. You know, they're making value by, you know, crank calling you from India, trying to deceive you, you know. They're making value by lying in their labels about what the product does. You know, it's all over the place, you know. And then they're also just overtly enslaving people in foreign countries where you can't see them, whipping them. It's really disgusting. Anyway, so incentivized fair earned distribution of the burdens and benefits. Well, there you go. The burdens and benefits of civilization. That's really all this economics thing is. Come on, let's have a nice incentivized fair earned distribution of the burdens and benefits of existing in civilization. What's wrong with that? It just makes sense to me, right? Yeah, okay. So again, I don't think that means that people are entitled to welfare checks at either extreme, right? The spawn of the rich aren't entitled to it. They aren't entitled to ownership. They should demonstrate why they should be owners. They should prove their merit in the real game like everybody else. Be productive and then earn it. Yeah, do it that way. And likewise, you know, people who think they're entitled to a life just because they're here on Earth, maybe you're entitled to some consideration that you're a feeling organism and that you have some needs, but yes, you're not entitled to a maid. Anyway, ownership of surplus of the means of production. So that in itself isn't a terrible thing, right? Ownership of surplus, or even ownership of businesses in and of itself, okay, that's not the end of the world, but it's this permanent legacy ownership. That's where it all goes down. That just ends up driving up prices. Everything just ends up being a bidding war, and once there's people that have perpetual bidding rights at a price, then prices always have to go up. And those prices are basically the salary that the rich get in terms of interest on their investment and their ownership, you know, their permanent salary for merely being the owner. And it's the biggest piece of the pie they pull out of the pie of productivity. But I mean, ideally, why bother with it? You don't need this ownership thing. And it just turns everybody into slaves, or the renters. It's kind of a nasty thing to turn your neighbor into a slave or a renter. Isn't that kind of a nasty thing to do to your neighbor? So I mean, we should be able to be more civilized than that. All right. So deserved versus inheritance. There really just isn't an argument, right? There's just no counter argument. It's about deserve. Deserve should have something to do with it, you know, to counter Clint Eastwood. Okay, that's what the economy should be. Deserve should have something to do with it, like the Olympics, and like baseball, and like football, and like every other contest we admire, every other single one, even war. We want the right side, the one that deserve to win. We don't want somebody to cheat in the war. And, you know, versus a cheat system. And, you know, there's just no defense. It's just cheating. It's just hero worship, glorification. Obviously, the common man has bought into this notion that this is somehow what they want to be as an owner, and that they somehow want to raise their children to be owners, you know, to be slave owners. That this is something to admire. They don't want their kids to cure cancer or to be productive or to do the human race some good. No, they want their kids to be loafers who sit on their butt and collect a paycheck for not doing a damn thing and then talk about how other people ought to pull up their bootstraps, you know, while they snort some cocaine. You know, complain about the drug culture. You know, if it wasn't so ironically idiotic, you just say, how could anybody fall for this? This is as dumb as some story about, like, you know, some naturalist guy, you know, going through the desert talking about God. I mean, this is just so stupid and insipid for people to fall for this line that we have to do it this ownership way, that, you know, we can't just want to do a good job and be productive and then get fairly compensated for the time we took out of our existence to do that. The compromise of our, you know, we weren't allowed to sit in our comfy chair and watch TV. We had to do some productive work. That should be good enough. We should all just want that for each other, to be as productive as you could be and get fairly treated get fairly compensated for your productivity. So anyway, I put the word the sport of fair trade. Yeah, because it just breaks the sport. There's just no way to make a counter arguments. Inherited possession of privilege is not a good idea. It just can't be a productive thing to do to the economy. It breaks fairness, and it's not likely to get any good work out of any of those people. I mean, just think how many Harvard graduates and Yale graduates never do anything with their knowledge they've acquired. Because why would they? They have a convertible already, they have a nice house already, they have a nice life set up for them. They go into some board meeting every now and then, say a few little this or that's, and that's it. So why should they use their acquired knowledge in any working kind of way? Yeah. So it's just waste. Anyway, all right, so let's get to some of this banking stuff, because this is always stuff that makes people crazy. You know, they go on about the Fed and the bankers and the conspiracies and all this other crap, and it's just all crap. So basically in this trading, this barter we're doing, you know, our value trading with somebody else, value for value. You're trading your production for their consumption, essentially, and vice versa. All right, well, so in this system, you have this idea of money to replace actual value, because you don't want to have to carry around value. You can't really carry around, you know, 5 years' work or something like that. I can do 5 years' work. You know, I can do this, I can do that. You know, especially the future stuff. You just can't carry it around. So the idea of money just makes it easy little coupon. You have this thing that says, this is worth value. A certain amount of stuff this will buy. And it doesn't have to be standardized on gold or anything else. It just has to be standardized in the sense there's a certain amount of it contingent to the real stuff in the world. Like there's a certain amount of stuff in the world, and there should only be enough money representing that stuff. Any more money than the amount of stuff is basically not money anymore. Paper on the stuff. It's like mortgage stuff. So the idea would be is that if you started a bank, let's say, what people would do is there'd be no money in the economy, and what they would do is they'd bring in a piece of paper saying, this is my house or this is my car, and they'd get money for that piece of paper for ownership, and the money would just represent something real, and there can be as much money as you want in the economy as long as it's tied to something real, a real asset. And then the money would all go away as soon as everybody just takes their money to the bank and says, give me back my stuff, give me back my house, give me back my car, when I don't need the money anymore, kind of thing. And that's how it should work, is money should represent stuff that has been monetized, but it should be real stuff. So in our world, what's happened is we had this real money, government money, and then you have this bank money. So bank money is just... it's just fake money, okay? It's an IOU piece of paper, but it's not as good as the money that requires real stuff. So it's created, you know, anytime somebody says, give me some money. And it can be collateralized. It can be somebody takes in a real piece of paper, a real asset. But even that sometimes is dangerous, as with the housing crisis, in the sense that there was a bunch of loans secured with assets that weren't worth as much as they thought, and so those loans went bad. Now they've bubbled that back up to maintain it, but it's just a bubble, and you know, it's all going to crash. That's the other theme in this story, is that probably all this doesn't matter because everything's going to get just so bad. Because it's just, see, this, the point is there's a whole bunch of this bank money, and there's other kinds of government money, the debt, okay, the bonds, that are just huge liabilities on the future, okay? I mean, we basically took something of value in, you know, mortgaged some of the United States of America, you know, your future taxes, essentially. That's what a bond represents. It basically represents that you're not going to pay taxes this year, you're going to pay taxes in the future, okay? And so that's what you're going to trade to get that bond back.
Glynnos, are you familiar with Eric Byrne's model of structural and transactional analysis?
Yeah, I'm even subscribed to Theremin Trees.
Good. Well, it seems like you're stuck in your rebellious child ego state.
I don't believe that to be true.
There you go again, Klinos. Disagreeing and refusing to accept the truth, like a rebellious child.
But it's you who's making
Stop blaming others, Klinos.
Oh, no.
Now, I want you to stop looking at life through your eyes and start thinking about it objectively.
Great.
Good. So as an objective adult, Klinos, describe what you see.
Finally. Okay, so putting human emotion aside, I see one thing that unites life.
Love?
What? No!
Spiritual energy?
What the fuck? Of course not.
Remember to be objective, Klinos. I don't want your rebellious child ego state to corrupt your clear, rational, adult ego state.
Okay. DNA.
DN what?
DNA. That's what unites all living things. To understand life, we should understand the function of the replicating molecule because-
Glynnos, stop! This is absurd. Can't you see that your bias is making you see life this way?
Which way?
You see life and the world as only physical matter, and it clouds your judgment.
Well, what else is there except physical matter?
Glynnos. This session is about you, not me.
Don't give me that shit. I say, as a fact, that we live in a materialistic universe. If you're gonna say otherwise, you're gonna have to prove why it's true, and not hide behind your stupid psychobabble fucking bullshit.
Oh, Glynnos. Truth is an illusion about which one has forgotten this is what it is.
That's a Spinoza quote, isn't it?
No, Glynnos. It's Nietzsche.
I'm pretty sure it's Spinoza.
No, it's definitely Nietzsche, boy. On truth and lies in an extra-moral sense. Page 46 or 47, if I'm not mistaken.
Are you absolutely sure that that's true?
Why, of course, Glynnos.
But I thought the truth is an illusion, about which one has forgotten that is what it is.
Playing these games with words is rather silly, Glynnos.
Exactly. So let's stop fucking around and stop talking shit and let's talk about the truth, okay?
As you wish, Glynnos. Let's begin.
So they create these pieces of paper, these IOUs, that are IOUs on real stuff. Again, remember, all this stuff has to be on something real, okay? Not fake, but real. And so now we have $20 trillion in debt, which is this monstrous number. And it would take, you know, a decade for the average worker, if he had a second job, to pay back that $20 trillion. $20 trillion is a lot of labor. Years and years and years and years of labor by the workforce that they would have to do for nothing. They would get nothing for it, no salary, no benefits. They would just be paying back what they've already consumed. So you can sort of get the idea, I think, that, you know, it's just, it's really a morass now because you have all these claims. So these claims, though, are what have made this bank money and the debt money of the government. See, ironically, the capitalists and the rich people are always complaining about deficit spending, but they're the ones that profit from it. They're the ones because it creates more money for them. Okay, more claims of ownership they can buy up. And that's the game of getting wealthy, is to just have pieces of paper that say you own something. So that's like the stock market. Now, but the stock market doesn't have any real value. See, I mean, everything is... Really, the real assets of the thing people own in the stock market is 40 to 1, 50 to 1. So it's, you know, $2 out of 100, you know, 2 cents out of a dollar bill worth of real value, if it ever had to be converted into something real. So the piece of paper has a, you know, a 98% of the paper has no stuff tied to it, no real stuff. But it does say value on it. It does say I'm rich if I own it. And I can, as long as everybody respects it, as long as everybody says, yeah, that stock is worth something, I can claim to be very wealthy. And I can use that wealth to buy companies, to buy production, to buy all kinds of things. But in the end, what it does is it just drives up prices. Because as the rich keep acquiring all these pieces of paper, the $20 trillion in debt, and all the other loans out there, all the mortgages, all the rest of that paper, as they keep pulling in all this paper, it gives them a tremendous amount of money to loan out to people, for people to borrow, to bid up prices. So that's how houses and everything else goes way up in value, is because the rich are willing to let people have the money almost for nothing, just because it's not doing anything sitting in their backyard, so they have to do something with it. So they loan it out to people who probably can't pay it back, but it doesn't matter to them because they'll just sell it as a stock to some sucker. But anyway, to people, it just creates bidding energy, because the rich could just buy the properties outright, but they don't want the liability of owning the property unless they can get a rent off of it, or they can resell it or do something else with it. So it's just easier just to loan money than it is to be an actual landlord. But the point is that the fact that they would buy it if the price falls to a certain level, they will buy them as just hard assets, because then the maintenance will be less expensive than the value of the thing, presumably in a future. You know, once the price drops all the way, then they can make money on the deal, kind of a thing. But anyway, just the idea that you have to understand is all this borrowed money, this is bank money, is like IOU money. Okay, there's no real stuff on it. There's just a bunch of debt that can't realistically be paid back. But owning those pieces of debt, as long as nobody says they're garbage, makes you rich. And so the real point will be is, when will that garbage money be revealed to be garbage money? And then everybody gets back to real money. They all run to something real. And once that'll be the run on the bank, is when they start running to some sort of real asset. And, because everybody will realize that, once the bankruptcy run starts, once one guy goes bankrupt, then he forces the people who owe him money to pay him back, and then they go bankrupt, and then they have to force people to pay them who can't pay them, and so they go bankrupt, and it just spirals out of control. And that's what they've contrived gimmicks to avoid. And so they have a gimmick where they had a bunch of junk bonds, and so what they did, they created a gimmick to keep the bonds from going bankrupt. So the government basically said, okay, we'll just guarantee all this junk. So you can own the junk, you can know it's junk, and it doesn't matter, because we'll guarantee the price of it. So we'll always buy it back for what you paid for it. And if it happens to go up, because it just happens to be a pile of junk that actually has some diamond in it, you get to keep the profit. Okay, so if there's any profit to be made, you can get the profit. We'll just protect you from the loss just for holding it, just for keeping it from going bankrupt. Because if it goes bankrupt, then all this other stuff has to go bankrupt. And so the government is basically FDIC insured $7 trillion worth of junk. And, it has, if the junk ever really has to be bought back by the government, it doesn't have the money to buy it back. And it can't. If it prints $7 trillion, the whole economy will crash. But anyway, this is always something people talk about, is printing money. And the federal government hasn't actually printed money yet. There's still only $1.29 trillion in the entire world economy. And that's all the money the Fed has printed. But the trick is that they've put a whole bunch of almost printed money in what are called reserve accounts at the Fed. And that money will be printed money if somebody ever withdraws it. If the banks ever take that money out, well, then it's printed money. That means printed versus taxed money. So the government can do things by just printing money, or it can do things by taxing to collect money to pay for the things. Or it can issue a bond, which it's not dishonest. It's just that it's overtly a concession that you're not doing good business if you have to keep borrowing money, if you keep putting it on the credit card. borrowing money is putting it on a credit card. I mean, you know, I'll consume today and pay tomorrow. And again, this is in the context where all these people who will argue for how we need to have all this legacy stuff is because of, you know, how much people love their children and love this. And obviously people don't really do any of that stuff if they're willing to saddle their children with the burdens of paying for the consumption, their consumption. I mean, we've consumed $20 trillion of stuff we didn't pay for. And basically said to the future, you pay for it. I mean, you can't get more cynical as a parent than to do that, right? So yeah, it's just really, really bad. And the arguments are just inane and insipid, but it's this propaganda thing. Somehow the rich have fooled the common working man into believing that it's in their interest to try to be rich. That being rich is the only thing that matters, and having the freedom to be rich is the only thing that matters. Being civilized, no, don't worry about civilization. If we all try to be rich, we'll automatically get civilization somehow. Somehow just a byproduct of all trying to be preposterous, wasteful consumers. Kings. If we all try to be a king, yeah, somehow that is all going to work out. And that's sort of the joke of it too, because this is a kind of a monarchy. You're not going to get into the royalty this way. You know, you're not going to get lucky. I mean, you might, you know, people do get lucky. They're born, you know, beautiful or something, and then they can put themselves on the market and, you know, and get themselves a ticket into the monarchy. But most of the time, yeah, most of us aren't likely to get married by a king. So, yeah, we're going to have to earn it. And earning your way in is, you know, that's like being a professional basketball player, just as silly. A prospect, because you know the game is stacked against you. You'll be sooner obliged, even if you're very inventive and you come up with some brilliant idea, you're going to be forced to sell it. You're going to be forced to sell your rights to it to get it ever into reality, and that's the real liability of having no power. And just you know, you can go through all the different kinds of, you know, misadventures that take place because of this unregulated capitalism. But you can just think of it in simple ways. Like, say, if you put up a little shop in a town selling, I don't know, something. I don't know, knives. Yeah. And there was a lot of demand for knives. And then some rich guy, you know, his wife has an obsession with knives, and she decides to open up a little, you know, feminine knife shop, whatever, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, she's got unlimited money, basically. She can lose money. She can not make money for 10 years. See, her old famous line was, is that, you know, he could lose $1 million for 100 years. And it still wouldn't make him a poor man. And so, yeah, how do you compete with somebody who can afford to lose $1 million a year, right? I mean, you're gonna have a hard time out-competing him in business. And that's basically the way a lot of capitalism works, is that the good businesses are ruined because there's a bad business that can afford to wipe them out. And you could argue that the Microsofts and the Amazons and all the big companies of the world have done that to get where they are, the Walmarts. And that once the competition is good and dead, well, then you can really get obscene. You know, then you can really take advantage. And, you know, that's just a failure of capitalism, unregulated. That will be its failure. The rich will always be able to game the system because they have a cushion against failure. Again, you can think of different metaphors, but, you know, when people say that this legacy thing is harmless, no, because it's a lot like having a net. Right? I mean, there's a big difference for you being at the circus, right? Say you're a tightrope walker, and you're going to be judged based on how great a trick you do, right? Well, that guy has a net. Right? The guy you're competing against has a net under him. You get no net. You get spikes on the floor. Flaming spikes of death and doom. Now, you're going to know that, well, I can't do my best trick because, you know, there's a 20% chance I'll fail doing my best trick, you know. And, you know, catastrophically fail, where I actually fall off the tightrope. Not only just look bad, but actually fall and die. So there's no way I could touch that trick, you know, where the other guy can. He'll always have advantages where he doesn't have to be looking at the flaming spikes on the floor. And that's just the one aspect of the advantages. Like I said, the cushion of having the trainers and having people on the ground telling you, I'll be back. I'm back. Yeah, lights on. Okay. So what was I? Tightrope, I think, or something, right? Yeah, so anyway, they have all kinds of help, you know, in terms of they can hire it done. You know, which, yeah, you're not going to beat the group of people, the mob, that's going to be performing against you. So anyway, that's the nature of the game.
Permitting the inheritance of ownership wealth is catastrophically bad social policy. It is plainly unearned distribution of the value produced by work. Inheritance creates permanent resource inflation, as the resources converted into surplus will have to be rented at interest back into public utility. Inheritance keeps resources off the public market, which in turn inflates prices. Inheritance provides no socially useful incentives to do productive work and creates opportunity for squander. Inheritance makes ownership nearly perpetual and in turn makes ownership more profitable than productive work. Inheritance is a cheat in the game of life. Ownership should be earned. Privilege should be earned. Advantage should be earned. And birthright is not earning. Productive workers pay everyone's bills. They pay for every privilege, and they create the value behind every dollar the wealthy squander. Nepotism might be reasonable human psychology, but it is bad social policy. In no other aspect of the game of life do we embrace birthright as a definer of right. The economy is the greatest game we play. Yet it is the only game where we permit grotesque unfairness. Adam Smith's invisible hand is nothing but a thief if it is filling something other than a working person's pocket.
So the other thing I wanted to talk about, you know, is just thinking about the claims on stuff thing. And this idea of the bidding up of prices. So you have to understand that inheritance or legacy wealth just allows this acquisition of these claims, and these claims end up buying land, for example, tons and tons of privately owned land. And so the price keeps going up, you know, because they're bidding against each other. We can't bid up for it, obviously. It's like the price of the means of production, the cost of businesses goes up and up and up because of this acquired claims of ownership, these IOU slips. They just keep bidding up the price of everything. So none of this stuff can ever be bought by the workers or by somebody who does regular work and has some initiative and collects a little bit of money. They can never come close to collecting enough money to own, to be an owner. But just think about it in terms of land utility and how you could get so much more use out of land if people who want to use the land could actually afford to buy the land. But the only way they can do that now is they have to be a sharecropper or they have to pay rent. And it's just too expensive to do business. You got to pay rents. And so it just, everything gets, it just bids up the prices on everything by having legacy wealth, because the money doesn't go back into the system. The asset doesn't go back on the market. It never goes back on the market at a reasonable price. And so the market's always limited. So it's a resource, cornering of the resource market. So the rich acquire ownership, they corner the market in terms of owning, and it just drives the price up and just makes the poor even poorer because they have even less opportunity to buy their way out of their poverty. They can't buy the land to do it with or the resources to do it with, because all those resources are now much more expensive than they would be if those rich people didn't have that debt money to outbid you with. And that's what it comes down to. It's all a bunch of debt money that's outbidding you. Say you're going to go buy a house. You got to compete with people who are borrowing a ton of money to buy that house. And so it just drives up the prices of everything. Yeah, it's just totally destructive to this good gameplay that we're seeking. You know, a nice, honest, fair game. Yeah, do good work, get paid for it, and, you know, do reasonable consumption. So again, waste is the bottom line. You're trying to avoid this waste, and you're not going to do that with this purely capitalistic system. It's going to have some rules, and it's going to have some umpires if you're going to play any kind of good game. And the game is just so dominated by that big money now. You know, 0.01% of the owners of the world own as much as the bottom 90% of the people. Insane numbers like that are the reality. So yeah, their ability to outbid you for everything exists. And it's that whole idea of outbidding you and keeping you down, meaning you're going to have to keep fighting to get up. And so then that's what people will say is the magic of capitalism, that it forces all this productivity out of people. But it forces them, it forces it through, you know, just desperate poverty as the whip. Like, you will be desperately poor if you don't do it. And that's all. It's just just taking advantage of desperation, exploiting desperation. That's a good game. Let's put that on TV. Exploiting desperation. And just have people extort other people into doing preposterously horrible things, you know, for enough food to feed their kids for a day. Yeah. I mean, you know, you could get poor people in Africa or something. You go there with some money, and you could just bribe them to do preposterously silly things. You know, actually lick their neighbor's ass or something, you know, for some money. You could actually do it. Would that be an expression of your civilization, an expression of your usefulness as a human being, your decency, your anything? No, or just an expression of the fact that this is a bug planet. Yeah, it's a bug planet. Bugs. You're all just bugs. To say you can't do better, we can't do better than that. To have no hope of us doing better than that. To not invest in us doing better than that. Just keep voting to not do better than that. That is failure. You know, if that's what you're doing with your life, then you're failing, in my opinion. Not that you care about my opinion. I'm just saying that's where the logic points, okay? It's a logical conclusion. If you can't understand, you know, how economics is not like baseball and football. Now, it doesn't play by any rational rules, and that it should. If you can't understand that, okay, yeah, you're just really dumb. I don't know where, you know. So understand, it's not the Fed's fault, it's not the banker's fault, it's not any individual piece of this machinery, because this machinery just exists to keep the rich rich. And so all of those little murders are just mechanisms being used to cover up the big murder, which is this inherent ownership. That's the big murder. That's the big crime against a rational system. Is once you make it entitlement, once you create those entitlements that don't require any thing to get in that group. You know, you could say the disabled are entitled to some sort of consideration, because it's, you know, not their fault kind of thing. And there's nothing they can, you know, they can't fix it. You know, they can't glue on legs or something. Practically. I mean, you can sort of kind of do that now, but and that we could, you know, even that we, there's so many resources, so many people who actually want to work and they want to contribute, and we don't even do the minor things necessary to create industries where they could do that, you know, by just giving them a little help and a little subsidy and make it possible for them to be productive. But we're so glued to this ownership game that you can't, you can't do anything that isn't something you can have owned. The fact that we have for-profit prisons now, it's just another, you're just saying, is that really the definition of civilization? For-profit prisons? You really want that as part of the definition of your civilization? These things are, when you look, you just think about it for a minute, and you just say, how did we get there? How did we fall for this? And again, I guess it all comes down to this nature of the selfish, nepotistic beast. You all think your kids are better than everybody else's kids or something like that. Apparently you think that way. You think yours are more entitled to a good deal. And somehow you want to be kings. You really do want to own other people. You really do want to grind them into serving you you want to whip other human beings into shape. You want to dump burdens on them for fun, for your profit, so you can drive around a Lamborghini and think you're really cool. You really want that. That's what you aspire to be. I really am just on the wrong planet. I don't know. Who am I talking to? You're just saying, how could people be this crass and ignorant? I mean, it's just, you're ignorant. You're ignorant. You really are. To think that's winning the game. Winning the game is owning. No, winning is giving more than you got. Giving more than you took. That's being a winner. And because you didn't need to take more. That's the other part of it. Controlling your own, getting out of the trap of your own addictions and fallacies and delusions. That's winning. So winning is being an honest producer and a reasonable consumer. That's winning the game of life. And that's the kind of thing we should incentivize in people. It's encourage them to do their best, because doing their best is a good thing. Yeah, and encourage them not to squander and waste. To try to optimize their performance as human beings, to get the most value out of themselves. It seems reasonable to me. But unfortunately, the nature of current politics would indicate that this is not reasonable to the average person voting. So anyway, that's probably enough. Yeah, so what other stuff is added to just make the point? I think the point's made, though. I guess I should just say a little bit on the idea of this idea of just having companies that aren't owned. That the real, the magic of it is that the owners don't really play a role. You just need somebody who can hire people competent to do the job. And that person has to be accountable to the consumers and the workers. And again, so if you just balance our power, just don't, like I said, workers, you don't want to make them owners, because as soon as they're owners, like I said, they're going to have they're going to be for cross purposes, and their incentives aren't going to be to, again, just be a good employee. Their incentive is going to be, how can I profit from my power? But it's really running a business is not brain surgery. It really isn't. And it can just do it. The business can function without having anybody own it. Nobody owning its production. Its production merely being for the purpose of producing and paying people to produce. Equitably giving the workers the profit of the enterprise. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's two people. You're two people in life. You're what you produce and you're what you consume. And both of those people have an interest, but they both can't vote at the same time. That's where it gets destructive. We have to regulate each other's sense of entitlement and have other people regulate ours. Because if we get to decide what we're worth, That's when we become very dangerous. That's where you end up with huge liabilities to human productivity. All right. I think I've done the job in under an hour. So until next time, Vloggerdome out. And such. Fuck you. You suck.
Cheating ain't a good thing. It's cheating. Fucking cheating. Why is your kid better? Why? You're going to make a rational argument why he deserves to cheat? Fuck you. How do you reduce suffering by cheating? What I'm making is a clear and decisive argument. The cunt fucking rich are not doing anything good on this fucking planet. We're talking about handing your kid billions of dollars. The subject of inheritance isn't giving your kid an extra stick of bubblegum. It's like giving him a gun, you dumbass. If all the gladiators have a sword and a shield, then it's a fair fight. If you give your fucking gladiator a motherfucking machine gun, then it's not a fair fight, is it? You can't play Monopoly if every time you say to the suckers, I automatically get Park Place, I get all those green things, I get two of the red things too, and then we're gonna play the game. Who the fuck but an asshole would play? The world would be better without cheating. Cheating ain't a good thing. That's the argument. I would decline playing Monopoly with the cheat of being given Park Place and Boardwalk. I would find it disgustingly humiliating to play a game against other people with a huge advantage like that. Boxing with a midget, or you can use a million examples. It's disgusting. And you scurvy shits like it. I'm arguing that we can understand fairness, shithead, and that we can apply the rules of fairness. You want to go back to a Mike Makes Right world? You want to just go based on who's willing to kill the quickest and who's biggest? We can go back to that world, bitch. You'd be okay with me. I don't mind stepping into Thunderdome with you. Fucking cunt. Yeah, no problem. If you're still a fucking believer in cheating, you haven't learned motherfucking cunt shit. So, fuck you. Yeah, they should cheat. You should cheat for your children. Why? Because of a piece of genetic code. That's the ethics you're teaching. And there's a pure efficiency to not fucking cheating. You think these incentive carrots, these value carrots, grow on a goddamn fucking tree? No, you know they goddamn don't, you cunt. They come out of somebody else's goddamn fucking labor, and they can be used to get people to do good things, or they can be used to get people to do bad things. How the world can be if we're rational and we don't let scum-sucking pieces of crap like you influence it. We bury you on the ash heap of motherfucking history as the scum of the goddamn earth and be really happy that we finally buried the scum of the goddamn fucking earth. I'm saying that I'll guarantee I'll create a more efficient, more productive, higher yield, happier society, much happier, much better society, more productive, more advanced, more progress, more everything if you get rid of inheritance. It would be nothing but a fucking wonderful tonic for the health of the human race. We'll be 5 times more productive in our work, and we will all live so much better. Incentive economics. People want to be productive. People like to earn money. So you give them incentive to earn more money, to live a better life, and they'll do that. Don't be a hypocrite. Don't throw shit. Don't ask for it, and you won't get it. You're not going to create less suffering by putting the incentive carrots all in one goddamn rich cunt's pocket. If you're still a fucking believer in cheating, you haven't learned motherfucking cunt shit. How fucking skanky and pus-covered their motherfucking cunts must be.
Being a human is just so swell. No, it's disgusting and revolting. You make me want to vomit. You just do. You make me want to vomit.
Want to see more of Vloggerdome? Want to make a counter-argument to anything said in this episode or one of our others? Please visit us at www.vloggerdome.com. See more episodes, conversations, extras, contests, live events, and more on our YouTube channel, Vloggerdome. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and come chat with us on the Video Soap forums, where you can make text arguments that might even end up on the show. We hope to hear from you! Thanks very much for watching! Be sure to join Vloggerdome next month as we explore the topic of virtual reality. See you then!